I am Elon Musk from Tesla. I would like to extend my sincere gratitude for inviting me and to be able to share my opinions on intelligent and connected vehicles boosted by digital technologies. Many people believe AI is the ultimate application of digital technologies, and it will push human society towards a digital civilization. It seems likely to me that AI will both serve and be served by humans in a symbiotic relationship that I hope will benefit both digital and biological intelligence. Moreover, with the widespread use of humanoid robots, physical work will become a choice. AI-powered robots will help people eliminate dangerous, repetitive, and boring tasks. Most immediately, intelligent and connected vehicles are the next generation of internet devices that will transform our lives. Tesla is much more than an electric car company. We are developing full self-driving vehicles with practical vision-based artificial intelligence, including chip development on the inference level and on the training level. I should emphasize that we believe autonomous driving can be achieved entirely by vision neural nets. After all, humans are running a biological vision neural net in order to drive, so it makes sense that computers will be able to drive by using a silicon camera neural net. Tesla is arguably the biggest robotics company because our cars are like semi-sentient robots on wheels. The economy is fundamentally built upon labor, so this will have profound implications as capital equipment enters the labor market. Data security is key to the success of intelligent and connected vehicles. It is not only closely linked to an individual's interests, but also matters to the whole society. At Tesla, we are glad to see a number of laws and regulations that have been released to strengthen data management. Tesla has set up a data center in China to localize all data generated for our business here, including production, sales, service, and charging. All personally identifiable information is securely stored in China without being transferred overseas. Only in very rare cases, for example, spare parts ordered from overseas, is data approved for transfer internationally. I believe data protection is not only an issue of one single company, but should be a mutual effort for all industry players. We are working with regulators on finding the best solution for data security. My frank observation is that China spends a lot of resources and efforts applying the latest digital technologies in different industries, including the automobile industry, making China a global leader in digitalization. Tesla will continue to expand investment and R&D efforts in China. Tesla hopes to contribute to build a digitized future of shared benefits, responsibilities, and governance.
AI is, I think, maybe more of a risk than people realize. Ironically, smart people tend to think AI is less of a risk because they think that they're so smart. But actually, we're just humans and we're quite dumb. It's amazing we got this far, frankly. So if you see the advancement of AI, it's clear that AI will exceed human intelligence in every way if these trends continue. And the list of things that the human mind can do better than AI is less and less every year. So, you know, hopefully that AI is coupled to human will, but it might not be. The long-term goal of Neuralink is to achieve sort of better symbiosis with AI and with the kind of human mind. In the short term, Neuralink, I think, will help solve a lot of brain injuries and diseases and spinal injuries and that kind of thing. But long-term, because one of the things that I'm getting quite esoteric here, but we are already a cyborg, really, in the sense that our phones and computers are an extension of ourselves, and you could say we arguably have the primitive kind of limbic system, the cortex, the higher thinking, and then we've got a tertiary layer which is silicon in the form of our computers and phones and everything. We have already somewhat merged with computers, but the issue we have is the communication rate, the bandwidth with the computers is low, especially output. If our output is two thumbs, that's, you know, we're talking maybe 10 bits per second or something like that. No, it's maybe 100 best case. It's a very slow output. And as the intelligence of the computer grows, if that communication link remains very tiny, I think we will necessarily decouple from computers just because our rate of communication is very slow. And so if we can solve the IO bandwidth question and by, you know, increase it by 1,000 or more, maybe 1,000,000, then you could have human machine symbiosis that is much better. I mean, that's at least one approach.
A question that was engendered by a remark you made in passing that I think is very interesting, which is where you said that there's a window of opportunity for us to get off the planet. And the question that occurred to me was, you followed that up with saying that you didn't know how long that window of opportunity would be open.
Yeah.
And there, you mentioned in passing, of course, the traditional things like, you know, exogenous forces like cometary impact or a near-Earth object. But I was wondering, you know, with all these compelling reasons for us to get off the planet, and including the compelling reason to have another refuge for the human race, what do you see as the biggest threats? And in particular, we have a wide range of expertise here. We've been talking about some of the problems that we think are the most important that are unresolved yet. I just wonder what you felt were the most important issues for us as a human race.
Yeah, I mean, in general, I've thought about this quite a lot. Just not say that I've thought about it correctly, but I've thought about it a lot. One of the bigger risks on Earth would be, you know, if we need to transition to sustainable energy, even if one discounts the CO2 capacity of the oceans and atmosphere, eventually we will run out of hydrocarbons to burn, and so we need something that's long-term sustainable. I kind of split my time between Tesla and SpaceX, and so Tesla's trying to accelerate the advent of sustainable energy. And that's, you know, to mitigate the risk on Earth. And then SpaceX is intended to mitigate like longer term risks that could potentially extinguish consciousness as we know it. I mean, we got the sort of delicate candle of consciousness sort of flickering in the darkness here. And I don't know if you guys have seen any evidence of aliens, but I sure haven't. I get asked that a lot. So, I think the Fermi paradox is just an incredibly interesting question. I'm not sure who said it, but there's either a lot of aliens or none. And equally, those answers are equally terrifying. I think but with respect to nearer term risks on Earth, obviously sustainable energy and, you know, potential non-linearities in the CO2 ppm in the atmosphere are a concern. If we start doing things like melting the Siberian tundra and that kind of thing. I'm probably less alarmist than most on climate change. I put myself in the moderate category on climate change. I just think it's the amount of inertia associated with the hydrocarbon economy is so gigantic that it will require a long time to make that transition. And so it's probably better to start it sooner rather than later. And that's why I describe fundamental good of Tesla as the degree to which it accelerates the advent of sustainable energy. It will happen, I think, anyway, but faster is better. As for risks on Earth, there's always good old nuclear Armageddon, you know, that's still one of the things. That's not out of the question. There's still a lot of nuclear missiles pointed all at us in the US and many parts of the world. I don't know what quite that risk is, but it's not zero. I think there's maybe some counterintuitive risks or that people don't put that much attention on. If you look at the birth rate trends, the birth rate trends are very negative. And in many countries are seeing population decline with no end in sight. So I think the very low birth rate, I think, is actually quite a significant risk, but an underappreciated one. And for population prediction, I would recommend taking things like the number of babies born last year and just multiplying that by the probable lifespan. And if you do that, you'll see numbers that are very, very bad for future populations.